Random House Audio presents What a Difference a Dog Makes. This is Dana Jennings. For my wife, Deborah, forever and ever, amen. Author's note, Bijou de Minuit, canine Zen master. In their mysterious and muttish ways, our dogs become our teachers. When I think about Bijou, I realize that besides being the family dog, she has also been a life coach, an accidental Zen master, if you will. If you pay close attention to your dog's behavior, there are any number of simple and useful lessons to be learned, proving that it isn't necessary to spend thousands of dollars and burn a month at some rarefied mountain retreat to find true enlightenment. Some dogs are seeing-eye dogs, but Bijou has opened our eyes, and she has become our seeing-life dog. She has, for example, taught us, nap in the sun whenever possible, play even when you're old and creaky, and live in the moment. Eat when you're hungry, drink when you're dry, and be sure to attach yourself to a visitor's leg when the spirit moves you. Yes, Bijou is a female, but she's a dominant female. These are just a few of the lessons from Bijou that we have taken to heart. Well, except for the part about the visitor's leg. But rather than squander all of her wisdom in a single chapter, I have seeded Bijou's nuggets to live by throughout this book, between chapters. And if you want to skip ahead and read them first, like tasty doggy treats, go right ahead. I myself have one more teaching to go with Bijou's. The dust-encrusted cliché tells us to stop and smell the roses, but I say, stop and pet the dog. I always make sure I give Bijou a friendly rub before I head out the door in the morning. Introduction. Miracles in the Moment. Our dogs constantly surprise us. They are our four-legged verbs. They dance when we come home from work, they fetch when we fling the ball, and they come running and panting when we call their names. Dogs are miracles in the moment. They teach us, in fact, that each moment is an absolute miracle, and they live in the eternal present. They don't fret over past mistakes or dwell on past glories either. The future is always now. We invite our dogs into our lives as just the family pet, but often they end up being canine candles that blaze and shine, illuminating our lives. My family's furry candle is a miniature poodle named Bijou de Minuit, Jewel of Midnight. And over the years, she has taught us countless lessons about life, love, and healing. Besides being the family dog, the only role we ever expected of her, Bijou has been a drinking buddy and a fuzzy shrink, an alarm clock and an angel of mercy, a sleeping partner and a sun worshiper, bunny lunger and carcass snuffler, beggar dog and thief, ear sniffer and tail chaser, and in the end, a devoted mystery with a cold black nose. When my younger son Owen and I were both seriously ill, him with liver failure, me with an aggressive prostate cancer, Bijou became even more than verb and miracle. She was a healing presence in our lives. Believe me, when your life is reduced to a large question mark, nothing feels better than having a 23-pound mutt snuggled up next to you. Owen and I both profoundly understand what a difference a dog makes. The summer that I recovered from radical surgery, Bijou would jump onto my sickbed, nuzzle me, and ask for her ears and pointy snout to be scritched and scratched. It made both of us happy as she sighed in doggish satisfaction. As I lazed and dozed at home, there was nothing sweeter in the world than to hear Bijou drink from her water dish outside my door. The gentle sound of her measured lap-lapping ferrying me to the waters of healing. And she was the subject of one of our favorite family jokes during my recuperation. You take the dog out. I have cancer. I spent a lot of time spading the past that summer, And fittingly, my very first memory is of a dog. It's dawn, and I'm standing in my crib. Dad is holding up a wriggling puppy, and it's licking my face, possibly administering my first baptism by tongue, and making me laugh. That's it, as sharp and fleeting as a dream. I asked my parents about that memory, wanted to confirm the truth of it, and they told me that the dog was a black lab puppy. A few weeks after we got her, she bolted out of the house and onto Route 125, where she was hit and killed. My folks couldn't recall her name. A poor, unknown puppy. Oh, let's call her Midnight. Undone by her doggish exuberance over 50 years ago. And yet she still lives in my memory, squirming and yipping and licking. And the thought of her too short life makes me want to cry, just as most thoughts of Bijou make me smile. Bijou is ordinary in being extraordinary. Good dogs, and most dogs are good dogs if given a chance, grant us the grace of their brief lives. The ancient rabbinic sages believed that in saving one life, it was as if the entire world had been saved. In that spirit, I would argue that in writing about one dog, it's as if I'm writing about the entire world, writing about every dog that has ever blessed our lives. Here is the story of the one dog that I know best, my every dog, Bijou de Minuit. Possession, or the curious incident of the dead bird in the kitchen. Like James Brown, that late great godfather of soul, dogs love the funk. Given a choice between a gentle stroll through a dandelion-dappled field and a romp and roll through the muck and the mire, a dog will go for the mud bath every time. The more foul and oozy, the better. Sometimes, I think, dogs believe that they are actually four-wheel drive vehicles with fur and tails. Dogs are connoisseurs of crunchy rabbit droppings and rank roast beef, of skanky, sweat-soaked socks and underwear, and the chance to give a deep snuff snuffle to a dead possum, skunk, or woodchuck is heaven on earth. Bijou is no exception. She might have that snooty little poodle pedigree, but her instincts are all mutt. And given that they're all nose, dogs have a clear advantage over us humans when it comes to detecting that delectable world of reek and skank. So, it's a quiet Sunday morning. My two boys are still asleep, as boys often are. My wife, Deb, is rustling in the kitchen, and Bijou and I are shuffling toward the back door. I hook her to the leash, but when I open the door, she pauses. "Come on, Bijou," sniffs, then lurches at what looks like a small pile of leaves riffling on the deck. When she dashes back into the house, instead of rushing down the walk to relieve herself, I, being a shrewd dog owner, know that something's up. "What have you got in your mouth, Bijou?" I hear Deb say.
"Grrr."
"Bijou?"
"Grrr."
"Oh, gross, Dana. She's got a bird. She's got a bird." At least it's dead, I hope. Bijou retreats to the far corner of the kitchen, the bird still planted in her mouth, its wings and feathers sticking out from either side of her lathered jaws. "Oh, cool, Bijou's caught a bird." "It was dead," I say. Our sons, Drew and Owen, who are always pumped for a confrontation between dad and dog, have stumbled and rumbled downstairs. Whenever Mom shrieks, "Oh, gross," that's a hard and fast signal to jump out of bed and scamper downstairs. And of course, there's nothing quite like the spectacle of watching Dad and Bijou go mano a dago. "What you gonna do, Dad?" the boys ask, their eyes gleaming with glee. It's like having Animal Planet right there in the kitchen, except I'm no unflappable crocodile hunter. I try the straightforward dog master approach first, knowing full well that it won't work. I stride over to Bijou, look her in the eye, and firmly say, "Bijou, drop it."
"Grrr."
All right. So we raised our kids better than we raised our dog. One more time. Bijou, drop it.
Grrr.
No question. Bijou's brain has been short-circuited by bird lust. What she really wants to do is carry her prey off to some dark, feral cave, eviscerate it, and chow down on the choicest bits. Instead, she's cornered, how embarrassing, in a kitchen in suburban New Jersey. That never ever happened to Cujo. Deb tries next, still hopeful. Bijou, want a treat? She shakes the box of milk bones at her like some kind of Native American shaman. Talk about desperate housewives. Bijou gives her a baleful glance. Yeah, right. I crouch in front of Bijou and slowly reach toward her. Bijou, drop it. And somehow, simultaneously, her jaws tighten on the bird. Mercifully, it is dead. And her lips curl back in a snarl. To be honest, I don't like how she's glaring at my bared throat. Bijou.
Grrr.
Deb. Dana, be careful. Bijou.
Grrr.
Boys. She gonna bite you, Dad? Bijou.
Grrr.
Me. Boys, get me the gardening gloves. Bijou.
Grrr.
Well, poodle wrestling isn't anywhere near as glamorous as alligator wrestling, but sometimes it just has to be done. And of course, in my family, I'm the designated poodle wrestler, not to mention poodle wrangler. The boys secure their spots on the kitchen bleachers as I tug on my garden gauntlets and become Sir Dana the Mortified of Godfrey Road, unhorsed, if not unmanned, by a mini-poo. I swear that my sons are gorging on popcorn and jujubes as they watch, but I'm probably mistaken. I march over to Bijou. Dana, be careful. Bend over her and try diplomacy one last time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.